In today's gospel, Peter gets a serious promotion. They're gathered in Caesarea Philippi, and Jesus wonders aloud what the crowds are saying about him. And so he polls his disciples about public opinion, and they report back to him that maybe he is John the Baptist or Elijah or another prophet risen anew. And as we heard, he turns to Simon Peter and asks, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answers, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." That is the right answer. But Peter was not just guessing. His response was testimony. His response was his experience of being, living, eating, teaching, healing with Jesus. It was Peter's experience of Jesus as healer, teacher, prophet. It was his experience that Jesus spoke with authority and conviction about God's kingdom. So his answer wasn't just a guess. It was his truth of being in relationship with Jesus. So as a response to Peter's answer, Jesus does four things. First, he offers them a powerful blessing, and he gives Peter a new name. No longer is he just Simon Peter, son of Jonah, but just Peter, which is the Greek word for rock. That's how we come to know Peter as the rock of faith, the rock in which Jesus will build his church. In fact, it's very likely that Jesus gave Peter the name this rock, because Jesus would have been familiar with the passage that we just heard from Isaiah this morning. "Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham and Sarah who bore you. For he was just one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many." Now the prophet Isaiah was addressing the Jewish people who had just returned back to Jerusalem after being for many, many years in exile in Babylonia. And they returned to their beloved city and found it in utter ruins. And in despair, they didn't know how they were going to rebuild. So the prophet Isaiah tells them, look to your ancestors. Look to the faithfulness of Abraham and Sarah. Because it was their faithfulness that built the house of Israel. In Peter, Jesus recognizes the faithfulness of his ancestors. And it is on this faithfulness that Jesus will build his church. So Jesus blesses Peter. He gives him a new name, a new identity, a new purpose, and offers him the keys to the kingdom. And we know that the kingdom is not a place, or it isn't a set of rules. God's kingdom is about relationship. It is about a worldview. It is about how we see and how we act, how we are in relationship with God and with one another. Jesus tells Peter, "I will give you the keys to the kingdom. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Now, this expression to bind and loose was common to Jewish rabbinic elders around the Torah. They could declare something forbidden, or they could declare it allowed. And throughout the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus is binding and loosening the teachings of the Torah. He declares certain actions as binding, as necessary, like mercy, and others that can be let go, given away, not required, like the purity laws. So this power to bind and loose is really the power to discern the will of God. So Jesus' intention is that he will build a church on faithfulness. He will build a church that will be known as a place where the kingdom of God is discerned, the will of God is discerned. So from the very beginnings, it remains the daunting task of the church to discern God's will on earth as it is in heaven. To become a church where we just don't pray the Lord's Prayer, but we live the Lord's Prayer. Who do you say that I am? What would your answer be? Today's gospel invites us to reflect not so much on what we believe, but how do we experience Jesus in our lives? How do we discern God's will? Do we experience Jesus as healer, teacher, reconciler, lover of souls? What would our testimony of Jesus be? For many years on my faith journey, I had a very hard time answering that question in an honest and authentic way. Some of my adolescent and young person's thinking stayed with me for a long time. I didn't experience Jesus as Savior because I didn't feel I needed saving. I didn't experience Jesus as healer because these age-old wounds were still there and carrying around with them, stayed with me. I didn't experience Jesus as reconciler because I had a hard time really understanding the sacrifice of the cross. And this very young adolescent kind of thought stayed with me. Like, I didn't really ask Jesus to die for me. So it took years of maturity, but also, quite frankly, going to seminary, becoming a priest, and getting a master's in divinity to really understand, or at least live into more fully, the sacrifice of the cross. So before, the cross was a source of confusion, a little bit of guilt, actually, quite frankly, a lot of guilt, and not necessarily a symbol of love for me. So what changed? How did I make the shift from how I viewed the cross? First, what happened, a lot of wonderful mentors and teachers came into my life, but I broadened my understanding of what sin meant. And I began to take prayer and meditation more seriously. So in terms of sin, I broadened the understanding, or I understood that sin was not so much about bad behavior and moral unworthiness. It is anything that alienates us from God. It's anything that keeps us separate. As Richard Rohr, a Franciscan theologian, describes sin as the loss of inner experience of who you are in God. And Jesus' mission was to break down all the barriers that alienate us, that keep us separate from the love and grace of God. So when I understood that, I could authentically call witness, I could authentically testify that Jesus is my Lord and Savior. Because there are so many forces at work, both internally and externally, that try to convince us that we are separate, we are alienated. That is why we need to be a people of prayer and meditation. Because it is through prayer that fuels faithfulness. It is through prayer and meditation that we experience the healing, reconciling love of God. An intentional prayer God lovingly gazes at all the parts of us that we refuse to see in ourselves or don't want to see, but sees us as good. And in prayer, we can meet that God's gaze back. In prayer, I can witness and testify that Jesus is the anointed one, the healing balm of our souls. So this question about who do you say that I am is really about who do we want to become? Paul tells us to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Become a living sacrifice. That is your spiritual worship. And sacrifice isn't a difficult thing in Paul's mind. Sacrifice is dedication to the will of God. So this commitment to prayer and meditation and to worship and to self-examination, that is how we discern the will of God. Jesus wants his church to be a church where we both live and pray the Lord's Prayer. And our church is as resilient or fragile as each of us is in our own faith. So we must remember that Jesus doesn't ask us this question just once and walk away. We remember that Jesus promised us he is in the midst of our community, where two or three are gathered, bidding us and blessing us every step of the way, and whispering in our ear, "Who do you say?"